Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, cats and dogs and everyone in between, welcome to Let's Talk Oconee SC, the show that where we take the O out of Oconee and replace it with oh so fun. Tune in for the quirkiest, craziest, downright hilarious conversations this side of the Savannah River. And who's bringing up all this uproarious banter? Well, hold on to your biscuits because we've got a lineup that's hotter than a summer day in South Carolina. First up, we have the one and only Cathy Cuckles Littleton, the Queen of Wit and the Empress of Entertainment. Then, ladies and gentlemen, joining her is the man with more charm than a southern drawl. It's Chris Cuckling Ruin. He's got jokes for days and a smile that could brighten even the gloomiest of Mondays. But wait, that's not all. We've got Rannie Riot Bond, the master of mischief and the sultan of silliness. You never know what he's going to say next, but one thing's for sure, it'll have you rolling on the floor laughing. And last but not least, it's the oh-so-talented myself, Jazzy Jeff Bryant, the man who puts the bride in brightening your day. With more Sewer South awards than you can shake a catfish at, Jeff is the undisputed king of comedic commentary. So grab your sweet tea, pull up a rocking chair, and get ready to laugh till your belly hurts. Tune in right now online via our website at letstalkoconeesc.com or catch us live on Facebook, YouTube, and other great locations. Here it is, Let's Talk Oconee SC, where the talk is always sweet and the laughter never ends. Right now. Well, hello, Don and Pam. Good to have y'all with us tonight.
Oh, they're here.
Hi.
Hi, guys. And everybody else, it is a pleasure to have you all. Happy Sunday evening, everyone. It felt a little like summer today, didn't it?
Well, I tell you, it was nice.
It was nice today.
It was beautiful.
A little 80-something degrees and, you know, the breeze and the wind and all sorts of good stuff. And I tell you, the last probably 72 hours, you would thought that we could have generated more power in windmills than anything, because I don't think I can recall seeing 3 days back to back with a lot of the wind that we've had and power outages and stuff. So welcome into our show this evening. We've got a lot to get to and some events that we'll talk about. One was Friday night. India Lancaster had a meet and greet held at the Wahala Depot and had a fantastic turnout. And I'm just so happy that India lived up to those promises to get those people those spaghetti dinners.
Somebody had to do it.
Yeah, I know.
Somebody had to fulfill those unkept promises.
Was it good?
It was wonderful.
I saw you had bread on it.
Oh, it was good.
I was in the community this weekend. Yesterday, we had a car show up in Salem and had the biggest turnout we've ever had for a car show. Had a wonderful, wonderful time up there in Salem.
I love that town.
So before we get underway with all our wonderful stuff, time now for a editorial. And there's been some things in the news here for the last week or two, particularly dealing with Clemson and the city. Well, I want to do a little editorial, and this is titled tonight, Preserving Community Character, A Call for Responsible Development. And this is going to be tied in with Oconee County, too, and some kudos going out to Pickens County. So here we go this evening. Well, as residents of Clemson and Oconee County, we're witnessing a concerning trend that threatens the very fabric of our communities. And, of course, it's called high-density developments. The unchecked proliferation of high-density housing projects not only poses environmental challenges, but also undermines the unique character and charm that drew many of us to these areas in the first place, and particularly one that's concerning with the Clemson, the high-rise, whatever you want to call it. It has the potential of taking up a complete area park that was built there, named after former Mayor Larry Abernathy in the city of Clemson. Of course, in the recent years, we've seen that in Clemson. If you drive across 123 and you come across into Pickens County, into Clemson, the first thing you see is a four or five story housing condo development right in as you cross into Pickens County there from Clemson. The towering apartment complex, student housing dominates the landscape. Now, we know that the growth and progress is inevitable. That's a given. We completely understand and we know that. But it's also can carry out a responsible and sustainable manner to preserving the integrity of the neighborhoods and protecting the quality of life. Similarly, in Oconee County is experiencing a similar phenomenon around here with spiraling housing developments encroaching on a once pristine natural area. As green space disappears, traffic congestion worsens, residents are left questioning the long-term impact of unchecked development on our environment and infrastructure. Amidst these challenges, though, there is some bright lights. And I'm going to give kudos to the County of Pickens. And at least the Pickens County Council has the testicular fortitude to do something that's tough by implementing another six-month moratorium on housing and other things, development, high density, so to speak. So our kudos goes out to Pickens County Council. At least you guys have the philosophy and the integrity to protect Pickens County at all costs. And they're demonstrating that with courage and foresight needed to safeguard community for future generations. Finally, this evening here on this editorial, it's time for Clemson and Oconee County to follow suit and prioritize responsible development practices. What have we preached on this show for months, if not years? For many, many times, we have said responsible development growth. We're not here to curtail growth. We're here to make sure that it is a responsible growth. It's responsible that it doesn't tax. There's the important word, tax, T-A-X, tax an overcomplicated infrastructure problem that is already brewing here in Oconee County. But no one wants to admit that. They'd rather go dump money down on I-85 in an area that has absolutely friggin' nothing. But yet, most of the development, most of your industrial complex of Oconee County is on Highway 11 and 123. We've said that over and over and over again. So as a concerned citizen, we must demand greater transparency and accountability from the local officials with developers, a.k.a. the Planning Commission of Oconee County. There's a commitment to terms right there. There's nothing planning about that organization, and has not been. Because had they had done the right job, they would have listened to the comprehensive plan and what citizens asked for. Well, I don't think they've listened to the citizens at all, if you want to be truthful. We cannot afford to sacrifice the character, the charm, that makes our community special in the terms of unchecked growth. It's a big word tonight, unchecked growth. Short-term profits. Let us come together as a community to advocate for thoughtful, sustainable development that respects our environment, preserves our heritage, enhances our quality of life. Together we can shape a future with growth that is balanced with preservation, ensuring that Clemson and the Oconee County area remain vibrant, thriving communities for generations to come. And June the 11th, you have the opportunity to make a change to put Oconee on the right direction. I've said this before, and every week we're going to say it again. Julian Davis, India Lancaster, and Gwen McPhail. That's the only way that Oconee is going to right the ship, because the current three that we've got has flushed it down the sewer and there ain't nothing there to pick it up. And we're going to have to pay to put water in the lines because there's nothing there. There you go.
Okay, can I start first?
Sure.
Okay, that was very good. Here's the thing that I want people to understand. So you watch the Planning Commission, you can see what they're doing. These guys are deflecting. They keep talking about needing input from people. Well, you know, they've got a comprehensive plan that they spent, you know, more than 80 grand on that people took the time. They said what they wanted. They talked about the basic things of planning that it had to do with zoning, properly spending the money on infrastructure, et cetera. Friday, I went to lunch with a friend of mine over at Hartwell Village. And I was there at 11:30. I mean, I hadn't been in Hartwell Village for a long time. You drive through that whole area, it is unbelievable, unbelievable. It's not so much where it's like so many people and cars. It's like you barely have any room getting by each other. And that's what we're seeing here. And
well, that's because they made that parking lot for EVs, not great big elitist trucks.
No, that's,
I have the same trouble.
I want to give Morgan.
Okay, well, wait a minute.
Hold on a minute. Morgan is asking about this moratorium, and I wanted to tell her it was 4 days ago Pickens County voted 5-1 to adopt the moratorium at this month's meeting. The ordinance states that the moratorium was needed due to unexpected, uncontrolled growth and development of high-density residential developments could overwhelm the infrastructure of Pickens County in the short and long term. Roy Costner, vice chairman of the Pickens County Council, said, "We want to pump the brakes on growth because we're growing exponentially." Costner proposed that apartments, tiny homes, and RV parks be included in the moratorium. He said over the next several months, the council will come up with standards that developers must follow when building these types of housing units. Pickens County gets it.
Right. So let me finish my point I was going to make before Rannie interjected. So when you look at it and you're talking about these moratoriums and you're talking about the planning, the thing that's bad is when you have to put a moratorium on a county. Because theoretically, you ought to be able to have anybody that legitimately owns property or buys property, they can build on it, they can do what they want with it. That's what's called property rights. The problem is, you do not have in our county any semblance of planning for growth. You can have, there are a lot of cities and a lot of counties around the country that have the same amount of people coming in, the same amount of growth, and they manage it because they're managing it apolitically and professionally. We don't do that. And that is the problem. That is the only problem. It's really that simple. People are taking advantage of the chaos and the obstacles like the OCC did. And if we could just get to the point where we were letting professionals help us, we could grow and actually have what we needed. Thanks.
Well, I mean, it's when you have a planning commission that stands, you have people on there that stand to benefit from unbridled growth and development. I mean, they're not going to do anything to stop it. I mean,
it's just sad.
They're gonna do cartwheels. What are they gonna?
I absolutely agree, Cathy. You can't have a real estate developer on the planning commission board that is in a position to lead the board.
Or people that are landlords and that get their property because people lose their property because they get priced out of their homes. I mean, so, you know, if you've got people that run a business like that, that are over here when the tax sale comes along, you know, they're going to do triple cartwheels if people come along and are priced out of their homes because, hey, that's, you know, Christmas for them.
You know,
what motivation do they have to help people stay in their homes? They don't have any because that's just another Christmas for them. To me, it's a conflict of interest. Now, whether or not on paper, whether there's some law, whether there's some ethical something, I don't know. But a thinking person, just an average thinking person, would say, hey, guys, maybe this isn't the person that you want here doing this. You know, because they're not going to have the common, everyday citizen. They're not going to have their best interest at heart. They're not going to be looking at everything that the rest of us are, you know, because...
Well, are you referring to the chairman of the planning commission now? That's, I'm going to be honest. He's a developer.
I don't know him.
Here's the thing, Jeff. If you are doing a business like development, mm-hmm. it's in your company's best interest to get as many of your employees involved in local government so that they can make those decisions that make it easier for your company. And if you're the largest taxpayer in the county, it probably also behooves you to put your employees in a position to run the county so that maybe you're getting a little bit more than right. what you might not necessarily down the road. So you see, you know, a chairman of the county council is an employee of the largest paying taxpayer in the county.
Mm-hmm.
And tell me that there's not some... he's not going against the company. I guarantee you that.
Well, let me follow up with what you and Cathy were saying. You're both right. But here's the thing that is beyond comprehension to me. So at first, before things really started getting bad, they probably thought, oh, they were cute, putting one over on everybody, like, hey, let's do this, and we'll kind of put roadblocks here or whatever. But now it's really getting bad. And when you look at how serious this, it's going to impact things like the hospital, the schools, the infrastructure, everything else. But when you guys are talking about this, there's one thing that is very strange. You've got David Nix on that planning commission. You've got something as simple as...
Again, he's an employer of the largest taxpayer in the county.
Right, but I think it's worse than that. You got...
Just saying.
Well, I know, and that's your opinion, and I don't disagree. So just let me finish. So you've got a comprehensive plan. A comprehensive plan is just what it is. It took input from citizens, and basically on the input, it put suggestions together. That's it. Nothing more. That was it. But you've got a county commissioner talking about things like, well, I don't support the comprehensive plan because it's too much like United Nations Agenda 21.
Well, Chris,
let me finish. Well, it's important that people understand this. So the question is this. You've got a local planning commissioner that is talking about a comprehensive plan with citizens coming in. How in the hell are you even getting something together like national policy? What does that even mean? That tells you how broken all of this is, and we don't stand a chance. So go ahead.
But here's the thing. You know, it would be great and noble that the Planning Commission and the County Council would take a look at the comprehensive plan. But they won't even look at the state constitution when they're making decisions.
Nope.
So why would they look at the comprehensive plan? If they don't care what the law is, why would they care what the citizens want?
Let's be honest. If you go back and you take a look, this comprehensive plan is mandated by South Carolina state law.
Right.
That's right.
Okay. And you have to do it every, mm-hmm. I think, 5 or 10 years or something like that. You know, the last time that we went through this, some of the stuff that was put in the comprehensive plan by the previous council, they did listen to them. They did utilize some of the things that was put in there, like, you know, expanding our park system. You know, we actually have other parks. They did a great job at Seneca Creek. The PRT did a great job with that system down there, building a brand new boat ramp and doing things that mm-hmm. the community really needs. But one of the biggest things was parks. And a little bit later on the show, we're going to talk about that because we just had some sort of meeting to discuss about tourism in Oconee County and just how important that tourism is to this county. And believe it or not, that is in the comp plan. The comp plan states more provide tourism. You know, to be honest with you, these county parks, and I know I'm getting off the beaten path here, but it's even getting tough for our own citizens to go rent a campsite. And it's been this way for 25, 30 years because so many people come from outside Oconee to rent our campgrounds. They camp here.
You
like from North Carolina, they come down here.
Reckon they spend any money while they're here?
Well, yeah. I mean, you know they do. I mean, they buy beer, bait, gas, restaurants, groceries. They come in here in the summer months and they put money in our economy.
They didn't call it the hungry hiker for nothing.
But this group here that is running the county now, they, like I said, they want to turn the lights off, roll it up, we're closed. When it comes to stuff like this, tourism makes money. It's easy money. I mean, we don't have to go out and worry about it. I mean, it's easy money, tourism. And that's a big portion, a part of this county.
And it's like a natural resource. Tourism. It's what they're doing is trying to put a square peg in a round hole to fit it what they want versus just going and exploiting the things and the tools that we already have.
We need more parks.
Yes, absolutely.
We have an area right now.
And you're not a tree hugger.
We have an area right now.
How are we going to do that, though, when we've got everybody building up houses
and
bulldozing all the trees and stuff?
We have an area right now that was supposed to have been developed in the 70s as a county park, which is Fall Creek Landing. They already had paved a road in there in the 70s. The reason it shut down was because of oil embargo. That whole area. Have you ever been up to Fall Creek Landing on a weekend? You can't get in there. You cannot use the boat ramps. Local people cannot get in there because everybody has come in and started using our resources. Randy, go ahead.
You mentioned earlier that we were going to talk about Friday night in India Lancaster.
Yeah, right.
Thing.
Yeah.
Well, one of the questions that was posed to her kind of seemed a little unconservative in the beginning, but looking back on it, it sounded different after I listened to it a couple of times. But this lady's like, well, what about bringing a cat bus to Mountain Rest or a sidewalk bicycle trail? But what that lady was actually trying to say is, what is the county doing for District 2? What has the county done for the people of Mountain Rest and Long Creek in the last 30 years? Where's the investment from the county in those parts of the county? That was her question.
Randy, that's a really good, valid point. I can't answer that.
And
that's why the people up there aren't funding Matt Durham's campaign, because he said he represents the people of District 2. He's been in office for 4 years, and he ain't done shit.
And let me ask you this, as your first responder, how many of those old folks up there on the mountain could use a ride somewhere, like to the doctor or to the grocery store or something like that?
But I couldn't tell you the amount of times that we've gotten a call and we go out there and it is legitimately, they've got a bag packed and they're sitting on the porch ready to go to the hospital because they ain't got nobody to take them except for the ambulance.
I mean, I'm not saying the cat bus, but seriously, there are folks out in the country and on the mountain and stuff, old folks that don't have a way to get around.
So my mother-in-law lives in the basement there at the house. God rest her soul. She had an appointment and nobody wanted to take her on account of, everybody's busy. So I called that Upstate for, what is it, old people Upstate?
Senior Solution
thing, right?
That's in Seneca.
Yeah, and I called them and I said, well, what did it take you y'all come up here in Long Creek and get her? And they're like, $80 one way. And I said, hell, I'll just take her for $160. But I mean, there's a need, and there's no one to serve it.
Well, so, I will say this. They did try to expand the cat bus, but if I remember correctly, it was shot down by Walhalla and Westminster.
Walhalla pitched a daggum fit. So,
but here, I don't think that the cat bus is the solution, but there is a need.
But then what? Let me ask this. Then what is the need? I mean,
the need is there's people that are underserved in the extreme corners of the county that our county council took an oath to do something to help them.
You got that
and
right.
Haven't done anything to help them. I like Julian Davis a lot, and I know he tries his best to do as much he can for his district, but he needs to come to Long Creek, take a look, walk around, and see what he can do to help those folks too. I mean, it's the truth.
Well, the question is this a part of what the county government should do? Is this actually what county government should do? Or should it be collective with everybody, including the municipalities, to provide this?
There ain't no municipality up in Mountain Rest, is there?
No, but I'm saying you've got Walhalla, Westminster, you got Seneca. Seneca has been was the prime resource driving behind to get the cat bus. And Seneca got the federal grants to pay for it. So, again, it was tried to expand the services throughout Oconee County, and the other two municipalities didn't want it. The comment was, we don't want to move the homeless around the county from Seneca to other parts.
Oh, for Pete's sake.
That's what was said.
The problem is we got homeless people in Mountain Rest regardless.
And that's just stupid, stupid, stupid. I've said it over and over again. You get people up there. Okay, what is in Walhalla? The courthouse is in Walhalla.
Your county
seat. The jail.
Your county seat.
The jail is in Walhalla.
Yep.
You get people up there. They have court dates. And they can't leave.
But it's this one guy.
They can't get there, or they miss a court date. And then our court system's already backed up. If they had a bus system to take them there, they would have a way to get there, well, and they would have a way to leave.
Think of it this way, too, guys. We're growing, you know? And if you put all these other developments in here and all this other, you know, we're very close to crossing that threshold of being a part of the DMA market. That is the Greenville-Spartanburg metro market. We have to hit 94,000 plus, I believe, is that threshold. We've got 80 now. You build these homes over here at 1,900, you might as well go ahead and say that's 85,000 right there, plus the other subdivisions. 94,000 population in Oconee is achievable within the next 5 years.
Well, you know what? When you look at what Rannie and Cathy are talking about with this transportation for these seniors or whatever, something like that's pretty simple. That is basically input into a plan. It's like, we have a need for this.
The comprehensive plan did make mention to that they wanted countywide transportation.
But one thing before you get going, Chris, and I wanted to say this. If Cat Bus came to Mountain Rest and Long Creek, I could probably put my kid on it in the morning and he could take it to school. A damn school bus won't even come down the road I live on because it's too dangerous.
I bet they wouldn't shove him out when he said
two
he didn't
miles
live
away
there
from
either.
Home. Yeah, right. Two miles from home.
I'm just saying that they might be benefiting that. I don't think it's the right answer, but
that's a solution.
But the root to that lady's question, the series of questions that she was asking, it after I listened to it a couple of times. It wasn't like, you know, wow, this crazy liberal wants a bicycle trail and a walking path and sidewalks up 28. What she was saying is that our district leaders aren't doing anything for their district. They're so consumed by something that's 50 miles away from where they're at and the people they serve. So what are you going to do for Mountain Rest, Matt Durham?
Well, these problems, we're talking about this transportation stuff, this is not going away.
No.
It's only, as we go through the next several years, it's only going to get worse. And, I mean, in the Seneca area, this has been something that was completely talked about 15 years ago. And then, of course, Cat Bus came along. And, you know, I hear these bad things about the Cat Bus and this, that, and the other. Well, there has been some issues with the Cat Bus. I mean, I'll be honest with you. At one time, a lot of the drugs came from Anderson. They were riding the Cat Bus and bringing drugs back into the Mill Hill.
Yeah, but Sawyer's down there now. He's got
I actually have a different take on that. I actually overheard a conversation of an older couple talking about how they saved their money and the miles on their vehicles. Because now they were retired and they were on a fixed income, and they would take the Cat Bus and go to Anderson to go out to eat a couple nights a week and leave their cars parked
but
at home.
I think that's great.
And that they liked to get out and they liked to talk to people because now that they were retired, they didn't really see anybody.
I ain't got no shame. During Fiesta Week in San Antonio, they had bus lanes for the buses to go through, and then all the traffic kind of sat there and did nothing. I got no shame. I rode the bus if I needed to go downtown then too.
Yeah, I mean, so and we were listening to this conversation because like in downtown. So and I think as you see trucks costing $90,000 to buy a vehicle and insurance going up. And taxes going up, I think you're going to see people moving
David
to public
Dahl,
transportation.
Okay, so, Cathy, I agree with you. The thing is that people start talking about the Cat Bus and they take these outliers like, well, they did this, they did. Okay, all that is there's an identification of a need for public transportation in the four corners of this county. You know, maybe you only can handle a little bit, but in this comprehensive plan, if you're going to do a plan, you need to expand public transportation because we are becoming, like Jeff said, more of a metropolitan area, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so with that, you should be thinking about transportation. The problem is what this planning commission does and what this county council does, they take little snippets of input. Like they'll take what Rannie says. Oh, you want Cat Bus. So the next thing they're going to do, they're going to talk about this shit for like 3 weeks. Oh, we got, they're already trying to figure out, well, how do we do that? You want, guys, you need to lean back and you need to talk about an overarching plan, and you need to fill in the details based on what the citizens of this county are telling you they need. And right now, they need building standards. We have growth coming in. It's tearing the hell out of this county, and we need to figure out, what I feel uncomfortable with is saying we need to stop it. Because then it's kind of like, who are we to say? That's not capitalism. But you got to, if you plan.
You have to stop it in order to put the development. You got to do a moratorium. That's the only way that you're going to get a handle on all of this going forward, is for a limited 6 months to a year, just okay. to like Pickens County's done,
right.
in order to come up with a development. My problem is, Chris, my problem is with this current planning commission, I'm not sure that they will even be able to get a job done in 6 months, because it seems like every time that we have a planning commission meeting, that there's something always getting kicked down to the curb. It's excuses. Oh, we can't do this or we can't do that. But it's strange to me that, by God, Pickens County, which has 100-something thousand plus population, is doing the things that we're dreaming of over here in Oconee, and we've got less damn people and more open spaces. But yet Pickens County is doing what their citizens want them to do.
Now, let me say one quick thing about the moratorium. I agree with you. You know why they're doing that? Because they're losing control. And we're uncomfortable saying we should do that. I'm uncomfortable saying we're doing it, because if you're doing a moratorium like that, that's because you're at a crisis stage. And you've lost control. It's like, holy crap, we have to stop it. Right now, we cannot handle it. So we're just going to stop it. Tough. We're sorry, people. We're going to stop it because we are out of control. And you're right. That's where it comes from.
Kevin just checks in and makes a great point. The council in January, now, again, it depends on if we have a new council all the way through. But if we do have a new council, I believe it will be up to them to get the job done and not the planning commission. The good thing of it is, if we have a new council, then the planning commission will change. That's another positive thing. Mm-hmm. And so with India, if she comes on and Gwen comes on, they will have the opportunity to elect their own people.
Put Frankie back. Put Frankie back. And Pat Williams.
You know, Jeff, you're right. You need What you need is mature leadership.
You just need people. You need
somebody
that
that's going to be apolitical and say, "Listen, guys, now wait a minute, Rannie, listen.
No,
you need mature leadership, and you're going to be that's going to be able to say, this is bullshit, guys. Are we in this to try to create something for this county? Are we going to play these little games of deflection and everything else? Because right now, that is what's happening. And you're seeing right now, like you just talked about, we're in a crisis stage. You can see it every single day, and not one of these guys is trying to stop it. This planning commission is not doing anything.
No.
They're only reacting to the people in the crowd that are scaring the hell out of them.
I think they're just putting on a show.
Exactly.
Tap dancing, and every time I hear Mike Johnson say something, it's just, okay, well, I know the background, and there it is. Well, we can't do anything. We're just an advisory board.
That's bullshit.
I've heard it over and over till I'm sick. Listen, we need to take a break.
I need to be on the planning commission.
Okay, well, you talk John Elliott and go from there. Right now, Teresa Spicer has that job.
Well, can I be at the at-large position?
Well, you just have to ask John, see if John will nominate you. Well, but I'd wait till January 1 before that happened.
All right, I'm going to do that.
Speaking of Oconee County Council, you do know that January 1 this year, Oconee County Council turns 50.
Yeah.
It will be the 50th anniversary of the very first county council. And I kind of wonder if that first council...
Is that silver or gold?
Silver? No, silver's 25. Gold's 50, isn't it? Mm-hmm. But anyway, something.
Well, we got the gold.
I wonder, though, what the first... I know Lamar Bells was one of the first county council members. But I wonder what I'll have to go back and pull the names to find out if any of them are alive. But I just wonder what they think now, since they were the very first council. What would they have to say? Like, what would Lamar actually have to say? I'd love to hear Lamar's comments.
Why don't you ask Rosemary what she thinks?
If you get Sleepy Glenn yes. out and Worthless Durham.
Well, I don't know about 50th anniversaries, but I've had 3 10th anniversaries.
Let's hope it stays that way, right? No more, right?
You never know.
All right, you all stay tuned. Hey, good evening to everybody. Thanks for being with us here. It's Let's Talk Oconee. As always, you can check out our website, letstalkoconeesc.com. Again, there's a school board meeting tomorrow. That's going to be at Seneca Middle, the new one. That one's going to be there. Planning commission meeting tomorrow, I believe. Is that right? Or no, I don't know. I haven't seen anything about a planning commission. I'll check that and find out. We'll be back on Let's Talk Oconee coming up right after this. Stay with us.
Me and you love great barbecue, you're gonna love what's coming to Twice a Town Tap Room in downtown Salem. It's the first annual Salem Barbecue Cook-Off. Categories for judging, including the Boston Butt Pulled Pork and any smoked meat you'd like to bring. It's hosted by Odyssey Farms and Twice a Town Tap Room. Mark your calendars now for Saturday, May 18th, located at 165 East Main Street in Salem. There'll be trophies for first and third places, cash prizes for all the winners, and amateurs only, please. Professionals are more than welcome to come for free samples and fun, but let's open this up to the amateurs only. It's the first annual Salem Barbecue Cook-Off, sponsored by Twice a Town Tap Room and Odyssey Farms from Salem. For more information, visit Twice a Town Tap Room on Facebook. Twice a Town Tap Room, proud to be a sponsor of Sunny 107.9 WFBS and LakeKiwiRadioOnline.com. That's Twice a Town Tap Room in Salem. Well, if you're ready to donate blood, the Blood Connection is ready to assist you. The Blood Connection, located on Sanford Boulevard right next to Oconee Memorial Hospital in Seneca. The Blood Connection is your local Blood Connection Center here in Seneca and the Upstate. And if you're ready to donate to save local lives, all you need to do is go to thebloodconnection.org for more information. There you can make an appointment. You can find out more about the Blood Connection and how you can help. Also, you can do more than just donate. You can host a blood drive. To get a blood drive scheduled, call 864-255-5000. With our blood mobile buses inside equipment, they can help you host a blood drive from almost anywhere. Save life with us. The community needs you. Again, for more information, visit thebloodconnection.org. That's thebloodconnection.org. And this message as a courtesy and a public service from Sunny 107.9 WFBS and LakeKiwiRadioOnline.com. Tom Jones on a Sunday evening watching Tony Adams throw his underwear at me. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, Cousin Tony, my friends, it is 7:38 Sunday evening here. Yes, I hate to admit it, but Tony Adams is my cousin. I really do hate it. I'm sorry, Cousin Tony. All right, welcome back. We're continuing our conversation. We're going to wrap up what we just talked about in the first half of the show. Rannie, I'm going to go ahead and let you have the floor because you want to talk about something, and we'll set the scene for the other conversation.
Well, I just wanted to make sure we mentioned that, this weekend I went down to Greenwood to the 3rd District Republican Convention, and we got to meet a lot of these candidates that are running for District 3, Jeff Duncan's seat. I kept asking them all which one was going to continue the Faith and Freedom Barbecue.
If you could get up and microphone.
Well, I asked all of them if they were going to do the Faith and Freedom Barbecue, and they didn't seem like they were interested, which is a real bummer. But I did meet this one candidate, and I thought he was something else. He professes that he's the only candidate that's been endorsed by Trump for District 3. His name is Mark Burns, and he's got a bus, and his bus is nice. So if you see the Burns bus riding around, wave at him. He's probably going to be your next District 3 congressman.
So he's been endorsed by Trump.
Yep.
And he's like Duncan? No, family faith and all that crap? And then he's had three mistresses?
He's a preacher and from South Carolina. So he's a personal spiritual advisor to Donald Trump. So if you see the Burns bus going around, give him an amen.
Well, he's a spiritual advisor to Donald Trump.
Yep.
I got to find me a spiritual advisor to this show.
He said in his campaign speech.
Why does it matter that he's endorsed by Trump?
But he said in his campaign speech that he actually saved Trump's life from an evil spider on his back. He smashed him.
Is he saving Trump from that case that goes before the
I don't know, but anyways, District 3.
I mean, paying off the porn stars and lying and all that. I mean.
All right, but anyways, District 3's got about 17 different people.
We got Democrats running right too, we do have Democrats.
Oh, yeah.
Running. Yeah, we do.
So, about time. I mean, I don't think these ones
Francis
are the ones
Goldner
running around.
From Walhalla.
Duncan, who called the FBI the Gestapo because they issued and actually served a legal warrant.
Yeah.
But, Kathy, did any of them like barbecue?
Yeah,
barbecue.
That barbecue. That's when they had that guy from Arizona, that sheriff from Arizona, the one that got arrested.
Right.
Where he was arresting people that theoretically were immigrants, they weren't, and they got raped in jail. Yeah, he was a guest speaker.
But anyways,
that's why we don't talk about that national issues.
Okay.
Yeah, like I said, Francis Goldner's from Wahala gal. Yeah.
But the biggest point of that, there's like 17 people running for that office.
Yes.
He got a lot to choose from.
Lots of choices there.
And there's nobody running against the auditor. There's two people running for treasurer. We need more choices.
We always do.
We need more choices. So what are you going to talk about next, Jeff?
We are going into a post that our very own Gwen McPhail of District 5, or the candidate, and this kind of ties in on a couple of things. Rannie, we all had a conversation earlier before the show, so I'm going to go ahead and read this for y'all. Gwen, about 8 hours ago, posted, heard from the Oconee Economic Alliance folks that they have secured 560 new jobs for our citizens and that many of them pay $40 per an hour. Sounds good until you talk with someone who looks really hard at the data. Many industrial jobs today are what we call temp positions, meaning that they work through a hiring agency when all necessary components are available for an assembly line to be running. If all the components aren't available, such as a ship stuck in a canal, a bridge going down, or some sort of other things, these positions don't report to work. These jobs probably provide access to benefits, but the cost is paid entirely by the employee and no retirement provisions are included, except perhaps a 401k or 403b that may or may not go with the employee if the person chooses to move. We need to hear about what kind of jobs are coming to Oconee, not just jobs. Chris, you want to start and then we'll go around?
Nah, she's right. I mean, when you look at this, you get these contract jobs, your hourly wage is higher because they can dump you whenever they want, and there's no benefits tied to it. And, you know, like I've said before, when Durham talks about these $40 to $60 an hour jobs, the one thing, first of all, if you just take that hourly wage that he's saying is going to happen simply because we're going to put a sewer pipe in the ground, that's not going to happen. That's more than double anything around here. And no company is going to pay that kind of money. The second thing is, he doesn't know to be able to say there's 37% added on top of that for benefits, which is the normal across the corporate. So you end up basically at over $100,000 for a guy hourly on the job.
Okay, Randy's sending me something we're going to put up on the screen here in just a few moments. Kathy?
Well, I agree that, you know, I've gotten to the point where when you see people make these promises or make these statements, and they're vague. We're going to have these jobs, or these companies are coming, or this person is going to do this. I'm to the point in life where it's like, name names, or who is it? If you don't have a name, if you don't have a time, if you don't have a date, then it ain't happening. It ain't real. So name names, y'all. What companies? When are they coming? Who are these people? And if you don't have those details, then it's not real. That's just as plain as day. If you don't have a name, of a company, and if you don't have an actual ink to paper, then it's not real, folks. It's just plain as that. If it's and the other thing is, if you're going to bring them here, and these are going to be temp jobs where people are getting screwed and they have to work 5 years making $13 an hour in hopes that they're going to get a job one day and make a real wage and have some benefits and some retirement, that's not helpful. That's not good. That's selling your people's soul to the devil. That's not fulfilling a promise. That's not a real job. That's, you know, they could do that anywhere. That's not helpful.
This past Friday, we had the State of Oconee that was put on by the Oconee Chamber of Commerce. And in the presentation, Jamie Gilbert, Economic Alliance Director, went through a couple of slides. One of the slides...
Well, this is the slide he was using when he made those statements.
Yes, and they were...
And it's real important that we look at the slide and the data that's on the slide. And if you guys will go with me down this road for a minute, the first bullet there is 2023-2024 comparison of the same time frame, January to March. And if we look at that... We've had less 23% less inquiries this year than we had last year. But we've had 83% more leads than we had last year. And same amount of projects that are ongoing.
All right, my question is 2023 and 2024 the same projects, or is it different projects?
You know, sometimes the data can be misleading depending on who is presenting it. Just like me presenting it, I hope that I'm not going to mislead anybody, but this is what we're reading. What do they say? Statistics never lie, but liars use statistics. 2024 leads and projects potential. Everybody that was there heard him say $1.3 billion worth of capital investments coming to Oconee County. And
16,000 jobs.
Well, 1,600. It says 1,160 jobs on there. And he probably misspoke and said 16,000 jobs, right? But then this dynamic fluid components expansion announced 10 new jobs. That probably did happen, $4.8 million. Then three pending announcements. This may or may not happen. $62 million in capital investment and 160 new jobs. But now this is where everybody's like, oh my goodness. A finalist for four more projects, 560 plus jobs, and he said these are jobs that are going to be $80 an hour or whatever he said. Well, I did some digging, and Mine America, the ones that are over there making granite into lithium chunks in Livonia and down that way, want to move their headquarters up here on the lake. Well, those are probably going to be $80 an hour jobs mm-hmm. or more, because the headquarters is full of senior executives. Mm-hmm. At Tudor from Wahala High, I ain't going to get a job at Mine America headquarters.
No.
That's not going to happen.
No.
And if he does get a job in there, he's taking out the trash or delivering the mail from desk to desk, and you don't get that. You don't get $80 an hour to do that. So potential is a bad word, because that means you're not performing if you have potential. So we got a long way to go to get to $1.3 billion in capital investment.
Let me add one thing to what you're saying, and it has to do with Cathy, too. So when the company is starting to do feelers and they're looking at different things, they don't make commitments. And they're very skittish about anybody knowing their name. So that's why they'll call things like Project Green or Project X or whatever. If they get to the point where they're making up fake names, then it's looking like you've got somebody on the hook, at least nibbling. But the thing about this, with this sewer, they spent this $25 million turning into $55 million on a bet, and their track record sucks with Golden Corner Commerce Park. You cannot sit there and tell citizens that are on the hook for this money that these jobs are coming because you think or your opinion is. There are companies out there that literally will talk to you about what your strengths are, or a county, what are the things you need to attract businesses, et cetera. And when you're going to start spending your money, you're going to be spending money in the areas that are deficient on why you're not attracting business. They're not doing this. They're spending millions and millions of dollars telling people that these $40 to $80 an hour jobs are coming. It's not. They have no idea. They're selling you a bill of goods. And the thing about it, I'm not talking about politics. These are people taking advantage of citizens in this county and throwing money down a rat hole.
I want Richard Blackwell back. He was one of the best economic alliance directors we've ever had. I mean, when he went to the bat for Oconee, he went to bat hard. He brought businesses in here. We have jobs, and a lot of that growth that we, far as the industry, goes back to Richard Blackwell and what he done. I haven't seen anything that would just make me jump up and say, I don't personally know Jamie Gilbert, but I haven't seen anything that would make me jump up and say he's the man that's going to lead county, bring jobs in here. And on top of that, we've had this discussion before. We have more jobs now than we know what to do with because everybody and their brother's hiring. So where is the workforce for all these people coming from?
So here's another one, another slide from that. And I don't think I would take the time to put it up there, but it does say that over the last decade, the last 10 years from 2014 till now, there's been 27 businesses, projects come to the county with a capital investment of $403,530, $403,530,000 with 1,384 jobs in the last 10 years.
How many?
1,384 jobs in the last
1,300 and something.
And 84 jobs in the last 10 years have come to Oconee
County. All right. How many of those have left?
Yeah, that's a good question.
How many of those have left?
That data wasn't presented.
That's right. Because we know that some of those jobs have left. Right.
And what was the hourly wage?
Well, so it doesn't say that either, but this last paragraph says that in 2023, new jobs were 143 to 215% higher than the 9 years prior annual average. So last year, 267 jobs were made in the county.
Only 200 and how many jobs?
267 new jobs in the county.
How much money did we spend to recruit these people, too?
There's a big question there.
I mean, none of the questions in any of this have been answered. How much money did it cost Oconee County?
But this last bullet point here, and I think this is where Ms. McPhail started her comments from, says the new jobs are expected to have an annual payroll of $17.3 million, with 48.6% of them having an hourly wage rate of $40 an hour or higher. So less than half of the jobs, new jobs coming, are going to have that but wage rate of $40 an hour or better.
In our conversations amongst us earlier that we had before the show, that 40 may not go, or that 80 may not go to the employee, because if we take into account, and we know for a fact a lot of these jobs here are temporary. They're hired through an employment agency, and then the employment agency gets their cut off the top of what that $40 per hour. Then if there's any insurance, half the time the employee has to pay that through that temporary agency. There is no...
Right, but 48.6%, less than half the new jobs coming have the potential of $40 an hour or better. Of course, because management, you only need so many managers in a facility to do anything.
Yeah.
And you don't pay anybody $40 an hour to ride a forklift in a warehouse. That's an $18 an hour job that HTI is going to hire for.
I just love how we all are told we're going to get these $40 to $80 hour jobs, but yet.
And it's like Chris has said over and over again, and I've said it, and we all know it. When people are coming to pick an area, when you look around and you're going to pick an, you're going to look at the government. You're going to look at the infrastructure. You're going to look at the towns. You're going to look at the amenities. And we're not there yet, man. I mean, if you're looking to bring a big industry, we're just not there yet.
Right, but they got two highlighted projects here. Seneca Mill Lofts redevelopment project. Redevelopment of Utica Mill property in Seneca. Over 400 apartment units, $100 million investment. Oconee Economic Alliance assisted with structuring the project's property tax incentives. Then they have the Thornwell Home for Children mixed use development. I don't know what that is or where it's at. Have you heard about that, Jeff? It's a 148-acre development, retail and multifamily housing. Estimated investment is $50 million and the 300 new job creation. OEA assisted with infrastructure issues. So 300 jobs in retail. And
that's the new, wait a minute, that is the new allegedly shopping center next to Walmart.
Okay. Well, they highlighted that as a win, and I agree that if we brought those shops in here, that'd be great.
Well, nothing's going to be built till you put an infrastructure in there because there's no sewer.
But 300 retail jobs is not going to pay $400, $40 an hour.
Nope. So Rannie, when you
the fella that manages the Longhorn Steakhouse would probably be lucky he's getting $60 an hour. Yeah. Being the general manager.
Why don't they just build a Bucky's up here on 123 and be done with it? $25 an hour to be a bathroom attendant. Sounds like a great job for me.
I love Bucky's. Hey, let me ask Cathy a question. As a woman, Cathy, say you're making a decision of millions of dollars and you're gonna invest in this area. You got a county council guy that puts in the sewer, and he's affiliated with this precinct up at Mountain Rest. And you're a woman.
Right.
And this guy's making a decision. He's shaking your hand, and you got a guy telling you in your ear that worked for you that he did some scouting. And he said, hey, you got to ask this guy. He's the head of this precinct up there, county council leader. He's got a Confederate flag, and you can add Christian and male to that list. In the U.S., you are free to live as you want. Unless you're white, straight, Republican, a gun owner, or Southern. This is the county council leader's post from Mountain Rest. And you're coming in and you're like, guys, this has nothing to do with being prejudiced against the South. You're a business leader, a woman, and you're on the under the gun to spend millions of dollars to develop, and somebody's whispering in your ear, did you see what this shit is? And these guys do not understand what that kind of crap sends a message to any top-tier company that may even get close to $40 an hour.
And I'm liable for all those people that work for me.
Yes!
I'm getting in the car, and I'm turning around, and I'm leaving.
Well, could you imagine being a senior executive at a company going, exactly what kind of employees am I going to get from there?
Hell, I was the one that did scouts. I wouldn't even put them on the damn list.
Well, I mean, could you imagine?
We got a sewer pipe. Oh, really? No shit. You got a sewer pipe like all these other counties?
I mean, could
here?
You imagine asking your folks to move to a place?
You'd never get your best leaders would never move here. They'd say, "I'm not going to educate my kids there if I got a young woman or a young girl 10 years old, that I'm on the hook for a commitment for 5 years, and they're going to have that kind of shit they're looking at." Guys, this is, I'm trying to tell you, I'm giving you facts.
And the thing of it is that you.
And I love this area.
And the thing of it is that people that have grown up here are so freaking numb to it that they don't see it as odd.
What's that?
That the Mountain Rest Precinct post. They just see it as everyday stuff.
That
they don't
you're a
understand.
Leader. Coming in there,
they don't understand
and you're county
that someone.
Council leader.
Kathy's right.
They don't see it. They don't understand that someone.
And I'm the dumbass. Who worked for a major corporation and did this shit. And I'm the dumbass that doesn't know this. Guys, I'm the one that's trying to help you. Jeff is trying to help you. Rannie is.
They don't.
I'm too passionate tonight, and I'm so happy to be back.
I think they do see it, Kathy. I've been all over the world. I've been a lot of places, seen a lot of things.
I've been to Neary and Utica Mill Village,
and that's where I was.
And you're gonna get me Shetlands there too.
But here's the thing. That's where I was going with that. Them people that do stuff like that post, they ain't never been nowhere. They don't know. They don't know that the entire world has done went changed and left them behind 60 years ago.
And they're hurting their fellow citizens.
And this is the last, this little bit of Appalachia is the last stronghold for that ideology. And it's the more they develop and the more they bring new people in here and the more they don't do things about it, that culture is going to change on them anyway. It's not going to
matter.
It's going
to change. The culture has changed.
But it has.
The problem is that generation that was like this have died out. The generation has changed.
They're not died out. They're on their way out.
They're on their way out. Yes, it's changed.
I don't know, man, because every week you watch the news, you look at North Carolina, you look at Tennessee, you look at, I mean, it's in the legislature. It has not changed, and that is the issue. I mean, and I know that's national, but it's more regional. It's like every week the South is like, hold my beer. Let's see who can be worse.
If you want low-wage jobs, then you need to stay with that mentality. There's a reason why you're going to get higher wage. The world's changed, and you got these people, to Kathy's point, they are hurting. I want the best for this community. I really do. I want the kids to have opportunities and careers like I did. I had to leave because I came from a small town. But these people that think like this, these people like Durham and these guys, they are hurting your children. You're going to have to just fess up and realize it.
But when I was growing up, I grew up in places just like this. Didn't have Duke because the farmers won and they made Appalachian Power put that lake somewhere else and dam up the river. Now they all starting to. But my granny, she told me, she said, you know, you got to get out of here, do something different. Go up there to Ohio and get you one of them good union jobs, make a lot of money, and then go
or Detroit.
Back. But she never mentioned moving south to get a job. But it was always move up north and get a job and make some money. I didn't do that. I joined the Navy and I didn't make money at all. But I did a lot of good stuff. And now I'm here. And it looks just like it did back home. When these factories and stuff, they would tease people. Oh, yeah, we're going to get these jobs. We're going to get these jobs. And all the while, the people are starving.
Well, they're living in poverty.
Standing in line.
We've heard it for the last, I've heard it
for
the last 7 years that, you know, Oconee, we're going to get all this. And then we do these deals and we give tax dollars away. Look, if it's tax dollars or somebody's going to invest and it's going to be a long term investment, it's different than us giving money to somebody that's going to be here for less than 5 years.
But the thing about it is in a lot of that Project Wash and these companies that move in and stuff, This place where I grew up was a mill town. It's called Freeze, Virginia. And they had an old cotton mill that was right on the river and had a dam that did the electricity for the town and did all that stuff. Well, when that went under, it was a vacant building. It was really cool to run around in there. But they're trying to get, you know, a little economic development going on. They had Anheuser-Busch wanted to come put a brewery in there. Now, these people said, we are too Christian to have a brewery in our town. Well, hellfire, they're all drunks. Every one of them. But they didn't want to make it. They just wanted to drink it. It was weird shit. All right. And then they had this lady who wanted to make pretty underwear in that thing. She was going to make a sewing factory out of it and make lingerie and stuff. Oh, Lord, we're too Christian for that. Well, now you know what they did. They tore the mill down. Ain't nothing there. And there ain't no jobs there. And they got some investors come in, and they've taken all those mill houses, and they turned them into Airbnbs. Tourism's the only thing they got
right.
Is that real pretty river, and ain't nobody going to live there, but about 9 people have bought all them mill houses and made them look real pretty, and you go up there, and the people are from New York and Alabama or just come from somewhere else to enjoy something different, but ain't no locals no more because they didn't accept the opportunities that came their way.
Look at Gwen and what she writes, and these local friends of ours that are the ones that like to trash it. Oh, I do that. I'm like, she's got some good ideas, and she seems like a nice lady. And these guys who never had that responsibility, never had to go through company downturns and find a different job, they're the experts. But I'm telling you, they're the ones that are hurting your children. They are the ones that have this mentality calling, you know what, guys, don't like me because of what I wear on the show. I don't give a shit. But I'm telling you the truth. I know how it was because I dealt in that. But they are the ones that would give me pause. I would not risk coming into an area where I had to have a diverse workforce, where I had to spend more time having HR deal with issues between a group that didn't accept diverse people than hitting my production numbers every damn week that I was getting my ass chewed for. That is reality. Nobody wants that risk. And these guys are leading you down this rat hole, and we are running out of time. Jeff talked to you about it. You know what's happening as far as this sprawl of everybody and these factories that aren't coming in. It's just killing us.
Well, there's no respite for the workforce. You know, we got this 148 store complex that we can't build because we don't have infrastructure to do that. But we want to send that infrastructure down to exit 4 for a hotel. And that's not $40 an hour wages down there either. The guy mowing the grass on the golf course, he's not making
money. Well, I just like the idea that we're going to have to pay thousands and thousands of dollars just to put water in the damn lines if nobody builds down there.
That's right. You said that. $1 million or something?
So no. How much was it, Randy?
I was talking to a fella that seemed to be very knowledgeable about what was going on. And he was telling me that there's been a sewer pipe from Return over there. That's where it's at, right, Jeff? The sewer pipe?
Yeah, Return. It's, Return Church Road.
To Fairplay for the last 17 years and ain't done nothing with it. They spend $50,000 a year putting water in it just to keep the pressure up and testing the pipe back to Return.
Well, the taxpayers
The problem is what I understood from this guy was 17 years ago when they put that pipe in there, it's not a 12-inch pipe, it's like an 8-inch pipe. And there's a great big reservoir there, or supposed to be an area for one to be built. And all the effluents from sewer south will be directed to that pond. But that pipe is too small to get it up to Return. This guy was suggesting that they may or may not have to truck the effluents from Fairplay to Return to make it, because the system won't flow.
You mean it won't travel by pipe, it'll travel by truck?
They'll have to pump it and truck it is what he was suggesting. And he told
me. Did you hear that, Jeff?
This guy told me that he had about 16 years experience with OJSRA. So, and if they don't get enough.
Did we sign up for that?
If we don't get enough people to sign on to the sewer south to create flow from exit 1, 2, 3, and 4 to that they'll actually have to put water in it to create the flow to move the effluents.
I never heard
into
that.
But they said they talked about that in the engineer.
That's right.
When the actual engineers came and had that meeting, they talked about that. And then a bunch of people got upset, and then they were like, no, no, no. No, that's not what that meant. You didn't really hear that. But that's what they really meant. And there's nothing down there but pine cones and dust.
So if you put...
You've got to be careful because certain people pick up pine cones with their pants down around their ankles. Did I say that? Did I say that?
Goodness.
That really actually happened.
But
that's a historical moment from yours truly, Jazzy Jeff. Right. But that literally did happen.
In a flower bed, yeah.
No, it was actually in the middle of the woods. They picked up pine cones with their pants down.
Well, but if we don't get enough people signed on to Sewer South to create the flow that's needed.
Former educator.
Then what? Then where are we going to be? We're going to have...
down there with our pants down around our ankles picking up pine cones.
$55 million to truck crap around.
It may be more than that.
Have y'all heard my analogy, though?
And we don't even have a truck to do that, I don't believe. So we're going to have to buy a truck.
Queen's got one.
Have you heard my analogy of this?
No.
Okay, listen, seriously. You're putting lines down there to put crap in the lines, okay, from Hartwell, the lower part, to bring it back up to Return. You're going to treat it. Then you're going to send those floating candy bars back down the Connor Ross Creek, which lines up in Lake Hartwell, that flows back down there. It's just an evolution cycle of turds. It goes round and round and round. Seriously. I'm serious. That's what we've done. We're sucking water from down there to bring it back up and treat it, then return it back down there.
And they want to build a resort down there because nothing says resort like doo-doo.
Boo-boo. Boo-boo.
Hey, I mean, so, you know, when you got the...
Is that the only way they can make it work?
Boo-boo.
That's how they're treating it. No, Chris, that's how the treatment works. You're putting it in down there. You're force-feeding it back up to the return community, to the wastewater treatment plant.
If it fits in the pipe.
Yeah. You're treating it there, okay? And then you're sending it back in, dumping it into the Connor Ross Creek. Connor Ross Creek flows into Lake Hartwell, okay? It goes into Lake Hartwell, and then the evolution cycle comes all the way back around. You're floating turds all the way around, circle around.
I'm telling you right now, this current county council has put Oconee County in a real shitty situation. That's what's happened. It is awful.
Oh God, I don't know what to say.
It's going to be hundreds of millions of dollars over the next 5 or 6 decades, and it's just going to keep compounding.
Why don't we just call the Cherokee Indians? Why don't we just get them? Why don't we get them back down here and tell them, okay, you all need to repossess your land. Mm-mm. Come back and repossess Kiwi Key. Then you build a high-rise apartments and condos up there. Then what you do, you put a parking deck in there, and all of a sudden, that's Indian reservation land. Well, cha-ching! There's the pot of gold on the video poker machine. The little leprechaun jumps across, and you rub that butt of that leprechaun. And then we have riverboat casinos going up in one end of Kiwi to the other. I'm telling you, cha-ching, Oconee is loaded. You don't have to worry about food. You don't have to worry about sewer. It's all paid for by video poker.
And the problem with...
But we can't have gambling here.
The problem with that,
that's
though,
a sin.
Well, you ain't supposed to have bingo, but certain people do play bingo. Bingo's illegal in South Carolina, but yet we still produce and we do bingo.
The problem with that Indian idea is...
It's their property.
Here's the thing.
We stole it from them.
Here's the thing. We got this illegal immigration crisis going on with all these people that are walking across the border.
The South Carolina-Georgia border?
No, the Texas border.
It's actually Transylvania and Jackson County. That's why we're the golden corner. They're coming across from Chattooga River this way.
But they're rafting.
But if you go over on 95, you'll see that. Or is that 77 where south of the border's at? Or used to be?
That's 95.
Yeah.
I-95. You talking about south of the border with the UFO?
Right. Yeah.
Well, they are to put a UFO down here at the Clemson Oconee County line.
So what about Texas? How did Texas get involved?
Show what Morgan just said.
Yeah, this is a good comment.
Which one?
Gambling is a sin unless you're gambling with taxpayer money.
Ooh. Oh, well, yeah.
I mean, she's right. It's...
It is a gamble.
Look at this one.
I think the Bible put the little stipulation on the gambling, son. You got to know when to hold them and know when to fold them.
That's right.
Sounds like Kenny Rogers is going to take us out tonight.
Oh, God in heaven.
We're coming up at 8:13.
Yeah, we're about done.
Anything else we need to touch on that we haven't touched on? Friday night, India had a great turnout.
It was really good. Yeah.
What about the barbecue?
I don't really care.
I wonder how that went. Okay, yeah, we don't care.
I don't really care.
Well, the thing about it is...
Any food poisoning?
Well, the thing about it is Bruce Taylor was told he couldn't come.
Why?
I don't know why, but obviously it was a closed event, but there were 3 county councilmen there, and they were discussing county business. There's a picture. If you go and look on Matt Durham's
page.
That
sounds like a quorum.
There was 3 of them there?
If you go and look, and if Matt Durham was the one taking the picture, it's on his website.
On the website or his Facebook page?
It's on his Matt Durham.
That sounds like a quorum.
Right?
Hold on.
Don't we have a county attorney that says they can't do that?
We don't
He was probably there, too, eating barbecue.
But in the picture, if Matt Durham took the picture, then you see Glenn Hart standing at the podium, and Don Mize is sitting over there by Kate. That's a courtroom, and Glenn Hart's talking, and he's probably talking to something about the county. So that's a quorum discussing county business.
Mm.
Am I right or am I wrong?
I'll be. Nothing will happen. It never does.
Well, I mean, it's not like they got the wherewithal to get anything done anyway. But I'm just saying.
It's like the partisan politics thing.
Is that the
they
one,
do
Rannie?
That stuff all the time.
No, that's not it.
It's great, though. When they get voted out, we won't have to listen to partisan politics during county meetings anymore.
You know what?
Yay! Oh, yeah, you'll have to listen to him because he'll be there.
Oh, I don't even want to. He'll be talking about
yeah,
boss.
But they
you know,
can
when
enforce
you talk
that
to the
rule,
boss man.
They can enforce the rules, so when they start that, they can just have him escorted out.
You know, I never heard anybody call anybody boss man unless it was like, what's that show when they drove that orange car? Dukes of Hazzard. That's it. That's boss man.
Like Boss Hog?
But then, y'all remember a couple weeks back.
I think it's on his counter page, Joe.
Yeah, that's what I'm looking for right now.
But a couple weeks back, and one of those newsletters came out from Matt Durham. He talked about how it was going to be the worst, most ugliest campaign. Yeah, that's the picture.
Where are they, though?
He'll pull it up and I'll show you.
I think they blocked him.
He was talking about how he needed money and wanted people to send him a lot of money because it was going to be a dirty campaign and his opposition was going to make it that way. It was going to make it expensive.
Oh, Lord.
Well, that donation cry didn't help out. On account of there's this post he made, and him Chris Hogan asked him, says, Matthew Durham, have you taken any contribution money from anyone in that area? And Matt says, my campaign is self-funded because nobody sent him any donations. No strings on this guy, unfortunately, he says. Chris Hogan says, campaign signs and all? Matt says, yep, yeah, had to buy them all. And people do not give you something for nothing. I'm running to represent the people of District 2, not special interests. But he hasn't done anything for the people of District 2. He's only doing things for special interest.
Yeah.
So in this picture, if you can pull it up for the public.
Can you show, point it out to me before I put it up?
Yeah, so if you look there, that dude that was pooping in the woods is at the podium, right?
Who is that?
That's Glenn Hart at the podium. Oh, okay. Matt Durham took the picture.
There's one.
He said
that's
he
two.
Had a great time at the barbecue.
Yeah.
Now, if you look back toward the AED on the back wall.
Uh-huh.
The AED, no, that right there.
Right
that's
there?
That's Don Mice, right beside Kate.
It is? Wow.
It is.
It is.
So you got.
That's Don.
Hold on a minute. I'm going to bring this up for everybody to see. That, hold on. Y'all all got to see this. It sure crap is.
That there is a quorum discussing county business. That South Carolina Ethics Commission needs to step in.
I'm getting ready to bring it up. It
looks like a bunch of lawbreakers.
All right, stand by. I'm bringing it up now. 3, 2, 1. This is a zoomed photo. And I'm going to blow it up. So what we're referring to is there's Don and there's Pam. And that, okay, yep, right, okay, yep, there it is. And then you've got there and, oh.
Ooh, you got more? What do you see? What else did you see?
Well, according to this, this is a quorum.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
According to the rules that what was said, a reason that they didn't go to that town hall meeting was because it would have been a quorum.
So this is illegal.
In the same building.
In the same building.
Oh, yeah. That's illegal then, isn't it?
And it would have been in this building, so that's kind of ironic, too.
Yeah, yeah.
So why
and
are they...
And yes, they would be discussing...
But here's the other thing. At this particular meeting, they're extorting every individual in there for $20.
So do you think they just don't know that they should do that or not?
Yeah, they know, and they knew that they were very deliberate.
So what are they doing? Just giving the finger to the citizens, you think?
That's exactly what it is, yeah.
Oh, giving the old finger. There you go, folks.
Hey, can you move that picture around and just make sure that you show Glenn at the podium? So that
yeah, I'm on.
So you trust them with $50 to $100 million, and they sit there and will basically...
Just lie
stick
straight,
it in your face and laugh at you.
Straight lie to you. Yeah.
Yeah, there you go.
Straight lie to you.
There you go.
I want to zoom this in right here.
Do
real
as
quick.
I say, not as
hey,
I do.
Oh, there's Golden Corners clearing.
Oh, yeah.
You better save it before he erases it.
Oh, there's some little giant rats out there.
I was just taking a look. God almighty, there's somebody else in there I see. Two of them. Oh, my God.
But anyways, the important part of that picture is the quorum and the fact that those three, led by Matt Durham, are lying to the county. They said they couldn't come and discuss the budget in a town hall forum because that would be a quorum.
Well,
but
we all
yet,
knew that
right
was
here they are.
Boo-boo.
But here they are in a private meeting designed to discuss county business.
Wait a minute. It's not a private meeting, Randy.
It was.
No, it's not, because they publicized this right as a public meeting, but where you could come.
They specifically told Bruce Taylor and Jim Mann they were not invited.
Doesn't matter. So, the post that they made where they said anybody could $20, right, that's a public meeting.
But here's the thing. Here's the thing.
I bet I could have gone.
They have created
I
now.
I bet you couldn't have.
They've created now a situation where they are proven liars.
Yeah, but why is the Journal reporting this?
Well, because that new newspaper that's coming out is going to start reporting the right facts and the news.
Mm.
The Golden Corner News seems to be the ticket there.
Yep.
But when you look at that and you set the new paper aside, the Journal. This is against what we're supposed to be
zoom
doing.
Zoom in. Maybe they're there.
No, I don't see them.
Citizens
okay, folks,
arrest.
I just.
You know what? You know what? Let me tell you.
That blows me away.
Yeah. Well, when we get the roundup, I'm going to say something.
But the problem is nothing will happen from this. They'll skirt by above this. I mean, there's no repercussions from this.
Hey, but the 5,722 people that watch our show all know now that these three guys are liars.
We knew that anyway.
Are we going to end the show on that?
I think we should, because I'm totally blown away. It
I
blows
am
me.
Too.
It,
who gets to go first? Rannie?
Y'all go, Rannie.
Rannie, you go first. I'm going last.
The thing about it is, these people lie to you, and it ain't going to change in the next time around when they're on council again in January. So don't put them there. Get rid of them. Flush them down the toilet. Like Kate said, he deceived her, and he's deceiving the people of Oconee County. Right there, you see it with your own eyes. All right? India done said Friday night that if she gets elected, she ain't going to beat the shit out of Jim. So we got nothing to worry about.
On a warm.
Okay,
right.
Kathy, your turn. Your birthday, your turn.
Yeah, I think that said it all. Yeah.
What, wait, there's a quorum. Before you do, Sean brought this up to our attention. Coming up Tuesday at the Oconee County Government Chambers, that was really never published except in the back pages of the local paper, there's a needs assessment public hearing taking place, and that will be at the Oconee County Chamber or Oconee County Council Chambers coming up on Tuesday, 4:23. And we'll have more about that as it comes closer. That'll be next week.
Yeah, I'll put that on our page as
that'd
well.
That'll be fine. Go ahead, yeah. Kathy.
She's done.
You
my
done?
Turn?
I'm finished.
Okay, yeah. So I'm going to end it with this. You've got Elliott and you got Davis on council. They're both Republicans. I'm a Democrat. But you know what? I trust Davis and Elliott. Our politics may be different on the national level on something. But in the end, you know, this is local. I trust them. Now, you look at this. This is a good example. I don't care whether somebody's a Republican or a Democrat. This tells you, if you don't, the reason we talk about this on our show, we don't trust them. And they're proving every time we see crap like this, I don't trust them. If they do this crap, they're doing the same thing with our money. And it's time you guys start wising up. Right is right, wrong is wrong.
It's interesting. I'm sitting here going back to that picture. And it's interesting to take a look at the people that liked the post. And one of them is your chairman of the planning commission.
No.
Oh!
He's there.
Mike!
He's there. I see him.
Mike, I'm disappointed in you. That makes it sound like you basically owe these guys.
Oh yeah.
But does. There's somebody else in this picture. I won't mention the name.
Oh golly, Jeff.
That
do.
Just blows me completely away. I don't know what to say.
Male or female?
It's a female.
Ooh. Oh, I see it.
That just tells me what's going on in this county.
Oh, God in heaven, guys.
Yep, and it's going to be most important.
White nationalism. That's what's going on in this county.
June the 11th is going to be a get out and vote.
All
That's
you gotta
all
do.
We got to say.
Hey, but Chris, there's your picture. Still up there.
Oh, is it up there? Is it?
All right. Well, folks, enjoyed it tonight. Y'all have a great
evening. Thank you. I was happy to be back.
I'm glad you're back, Chris, and happy birthday to you, Cathy.
Thank you.
Happy birthday to Cathy.
I'm going to take the shirt off for you. Yep. Turn that camera off.
Let's go
magic,
home first,
magic
okay?
Magic Rannie.
Please. I don't know what to say now. Bye, y'all. Have a good evening, everybody. Thanks for listening and watching here on Let's Talk Oconee SC.com.
Thank you.